Hello everyone, namaste. It's so wonderful to be speaking to so many climate warriors in this fantastic partnership between Terre Foundation and the Delhi University, one of the most prestigious universities in Bharat or India. This is a wonderful, wonderful partnership. And I know that 25 universities from all over northern India are represented. And I know that you will take major steps towards zero emission universities. A big thank you to my friends Rajendra Shendra and Prakash Javadkar, who are so crucial for this to happen. I think you're all aware that we are facing a triple environment crisis. Pollution, which has been very visible in Delhi over the last few days, destruction of environment and ecosystems, and climate change. That's the bad news, and we see this all over the world, wildfires in Canada and the United States, floods in Pakistan, droughts in China. We have seen so many results of climate warming in the last few years. All over the planet, so the crisis is visible to everyone. But the good news is also very clear. We have all the finances, all the policies, and all the technologies we need to solve this crisis. Of course, technologies will improve in the years to come, but they are already there, available for all of us. India is front and center in this. India is not a major cause of the climate destruction. The United States so far has emitted 25 times more than India per capita. So obviously the main responsibility for solving the crisis lies with the United States and in Europe, those who have emitted the most. But what is so good to see is that even if India is not the cause of the crisis, India is so important to the solution of the crisis. Prime Minister Modi has long passed the old debate on whether India should develop or India should take care of Mother Earth into how can India lift every Indian out of poverty, create jobs for many more Indians by doing it by going green, taking care of Mother Earth. And it's launching green missions by the day. Green hydrogen mission for India, electric batteries mission for India, electric cars mission for India. And all these missions are using the state as a vehicle to drive the market in a green direction. That's exactly what a prime minister should do. And Prime Minister Modi is now a world leader in going green. And this is reflected, interesting enough, also in action in many of the states. Also in states which are not with the BJP and who have different views with the Prime Minister on different other issues, like say Tamil Nadu, but on fighting for the green future of India, they are at one. They are the same, the issues, the policies are very similar. Let me mention four core areas, which of course are key for India at large, but also for the struggle to make university campuses green. First, green energies. A couple of months ago, I went to a small historical city in Madhya Pradesh. It's called Sanchi. It's a very historical town. There are some stupas there from the time of Buddha, so they're very, very old, and many people go to see these wonderful historical relics. But we went to see the solar panels of Sanchi. And two new solar plants are now bringing energy to the people in the city of Sanchi, and they're making it possible for the farmers in the region to pump water to the agriculture without emissions, just using solar energy for pumping water. And added to all this, they've also established street lighting based on solar, which many people, and particularly maybe women, feel much more comfortable to walk out at night when there is light. So India has now moved to become one of the core solar nations in the world. China is the lead, but India for sure in the future will be the second biggest solar nation on planet Earth. And of course, the Sanchi example would not be interesting if it was just Sanchi, but we see this all over India. Tamil Nadu, for instance, Chief Minister Stalin is launching big plans to go solar, to go into wind power, to go into offshore wind power, and in so many other areas. And of course, universities need to employ renewable energies. Second area, transport. 10 years ago, there was hardly any metros in India. Yes, there were in some metro line in Delhi, but it was very limited. Now, Delhi Metro is one of the big metro systems in the world, and 25 cities in Bharat are constructing metros. I mean, some of them are not metros, they're elevated up in the air, but it's constructing a mass transit system which will make the Indian cities much greener and avoid some of the pollution which we now see. In Hyderabad, a month ago, I was very, very privileged to be able to open a new bike path through Hyderabad, 23 kilometers, a wonderful paved bike lane, and all under a solar roof, so that you get solar energy from the bike path. This was inspired by a tweet I made, which was seen by the leadership of the state of Telangana from South Korea, which has done this. And then they decided to implement in Hyderabad, and I hope it can inspire many other cities to make it more feasible for people to go biking, for students to come to the universities by biking, but even making this in the shade of solar panels, promoting renewable energy all the same. And in Tamil Nadu, Ola, the car sharing company, has set up a fantastic, wonderful plan. 2,000 young Tamil women working there, producing electric vehicles, electric bikes. And their slogan is fantastic. They say, Tesla for the West, Ola for the rest. Showing the example or their leadership that India can provide low-cost electric vehicles for the world and then capture market, making jobs, make it in India, as the Prime Minister would have said. Thirdly, tree planting. Every university can plant trees, every student can plant trees, and we see this happening in many parts of India. In Madhya Pradesh, Chief Minister Chauhan is planting one tree every day. Well, through that he's creating a small little forest in Bhopal, but more importantly, he's inspiring 80 million people in the great state of Madhya Pradesh to plant trees. Madhya Pradesh population is the same as Germany, so this really matters. And in Telangana, they have increased the tree cover by 7% over the last few years. And Hyderabad is a global front runner in urban parks. In fact, there are 180 small and big urban parks in Hyderabad, making the city a lot more livable, but of course also very good for climate and Mother Earth. And finally, we need to create a circular economy. I want all students, all universities to find alternatives to plastics. We don't need to drink from a plastic cup. We can drink from a normal glass like this. We don't need plastic straws. If you need a straw, it can be from bamboo. And the city of Indore really inspires India and the world. That's the nickname of being the cleanest city in India. And I visited it earlier this year. And it's simply magnificent. It's so clean, there's not a paper in the streets, because a visionary leaders in the city has made it possible for people to sort the garbage at home, and even using the garbage as fuel for the city buses through a waste to energy plant. So when we combine all this, energy, transport, greening of landscapes and cities, and a circular economy where we avoid plastics and recycle whatever we can, we have the recipe for the future. And universities are front and center in this. Young people are nearly always those who lead new charges into the future. And the big, big, big challenge in the 21st century is to create an economy which brings everyone out of poverty, everyone up to the middle class, but let's do it in such a way that we do not destroy this planet. And going green is the one recipe which will solve all this. I wish you big success with this important meeting in Delhi. I hope all the universities from Northern India will now have the ambition of being zero emission universities. And I thank you for listening. Jan Jalad.